everyone, and welcome to Dr. Deep State. Will Tucker and I have a special guest again today. We have Dr. Kozinski from the West Coast, and we're all going to be talking about this concept that we're probably going to roll into something like saying true things, the inspiration. So there's two links below if you want to check them out. They're both really quick videos. We're going to here and there be referencing those videos. They're both less than 6 minutes long. And so you're going to hear us talking about that throughout. Will, would you please help me introduce our guest today?
Sure. Yeah, we'd like to welcome Dr. Thaddeus Kozinski again to our show. He is the author of Modernity as Apocalypse, and he has a Substack that we would like to recommend to our audience called Clemmy, Deconstructing Propaganda for the Glory of God. You can find that at Thaddeus Kozinski at Substack.com.
Dot Substack.com.
I'm sorry.
Thaddeus Kozinski dot Substack.com.
Yeah. Dot Substack.com. I'm sorry about that. Where he writes about, he's introduced us to a philosopher named D.C. Schindler, who we'll probably talk about a little bit in this conversation. And he does some deep dives into his work as well as other issues related to the pandemic and logos and Catholic theology. So without further ado, let's get started with our conversation, guys.
So Dr. Kozinski, have you been thinking about, like, because I'm writing about this heavy, these underlying conditions in the deepest sense, I think what's going on in the crisis in the world today is theological and psychic. And I'm going with a lot of things. The core of everything comes back to the psyche, the individual, collective, cosmic. And you quickly shared a few ideas with me, and I said, that's it. Yeah. Tell me about what we were talking about a moment ago, please.
Yeah, sure. Well, I was just observing some of the little customs that we have at a school where I'm teaching. And I didn't pay attention to how important these kind of social, institutional, cultural customs are. But I was actually just doing a kind of phenomenological observation, like what exactly is happening here? So little things, like we had a get-together with the seniors and some teachers. And we prepared a kind of skit, you know, for the students, where we would imitate them, like as they are in class. So there was humor there. There was obviously kind of love and respect, but all enough so that you could have this kind of humor that signifies a kind of emotional, psychological intimacy. That's a kind of friendship there, a trust, and it produced humor and joy, and wit, and there was witticisms abound. And then the students did the same thing for the teachers. So you had this playful, loving, friendly kind of humorous and generous, a gift giving in this social environment. And I was just observing how this went and the kind of joy it produced. And it was all basically rooted in classical education, in seminar discussion, Socratic discussion. It was all that was sort of bound up in it. And then we had good food, we had music, and nobody, of course, is wearing masks. I was just observing the kind of importance of these kind of festive social gestures of friendship, based in truth, based in goodness. And it seems to me that there are, of course, examples that we could all bring to the table about this. But what's being attacked and distorted and perverted and an attempt to destroy are just these very simple kind of social activities. And what I was thinking to myself is what these require you to do is you have to be in relation to another, in relation to the truth of things, the reality of things, you're acting in a kind of loving way towards the neighbor in a professional situation, institutional situation. And it requires you to get out of your mindset of self-will, of power, of manipulation, which is what we tend towards when we're isolated, when we're in a state of fear, when we're in a state of distrust, when we are have been harmed or traumatized, all these things that the devil wants to, the mode he wants us to be in. These social things are kind of organic and they develop naturally without much planning. They're almost kind of creations of God. These kind of institutions, these small little rituals or customs, and what they do is they kind of force you to have to get out of that selfishness. And I was thinking to myself, what happens when those are gone, when those are perverted, when those are undermined, or when they're seen as not important or not essential? And the answer is absolute disaster. The answer is absolute degradation of the person. A good example of this is simply the wearing of a mask. The wearing of a mask would destroy all those kind of situations, those relational activities, undermine them, pervert them. And that's exactly what they wanted 3 years ago. And so, I don't know, this is kind of a microcosm, a little small example of the spiritual warfare we're under. And it's also something that we can fight against, that we can help to produce and create. I mean, just think of all the things that poison this kind of activity, not just ideological compromises and the suspicion and paranoia and fear that produces, but how about just like having somebody in the social situation who's kind of narcissistic and wants to monopolize and manipulate, or how about just an environment where you're only doing this kind of thing for your own self-promotion or prestige, or all that also destroys. But when it's absent, when you actually have just a healthy relational activity like this, celebrating and festivity for its own end, for the purpose of friendship and joy and love, I mean, that itself is what the devil hates the most. That itself is what produces an acknowledgement of God, an awareness of God, an awareness of the transcendent. It's like what Joseph Pieper says, that the purpose of all life is to transcend the workaday world and enter into the world of festivity and worship. And these little examples, humble examples, are ways that we are forced to get out of our hellish existence and orientation, existential mode. And they are built into society by God for that very purpose. And these are being attacked like they have never been attacked in history. And so I just think we have to be very attentive to these things. Yeah. So that was my insight, if it's an insight.
Got a lot to take. Will, do you want to wait for a minute? I have a few ideas. Do you want to jump in for a moment?
Yeah, I could maybe say a couple things here before you start, but I was just going to say one of the concepts that Catherine Watt, one of the videos presenters as we're going to be discussing, introduces is this idea of like a social immune system or a immune system of the body politic. So what you're describing in this convivial space of mutual sharing and care and humor, it seems to talk to this space of consensus in which we feel safe, we feel secure, and we feel like we mutually belong to something that's outside of ourselves. And so whenever we put on the mask and we go into the social media space, we kind of enclose ourselves off and we have this feeling of mutual distrust. The consistent point is now fear, threat, and this mutual distrust of the social space that we're constantly in protection mode. And then we see anyone who's not participating in that consensus as a threat to the immune system. So unless you want to say anything.
No, that was very well said. Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah, it was well. Thank you. I could just go here. I just took these notes. I don't want to go too long. before I kind of get into the main idea, when you said, you know, one of her part of her language, we still got to start thinking of somebody, this is weaponized, something's being used against us. That's one thing, you know, at some level, because then you interact with the world differently, or good or bad. But before I get to the main idea, when you were talking about just the niceties, that civilization and appreciating the hierarchy and just your place in it, and when that goes, but the idea when those manners and everything, the things that make life pretty. And I always just think of an architecture, the architecture of the Elizabethan age could just, you can walk around it and it can lift you up outside of it or inside of it. And so the smashing of that mid-20th century into these things that look like car parks, you know, and you can see it in every university. There's the part that used to be that's grand and beautiful and you can still have a relationship with it at some heart. And then there's the mid-century part that's so stark. Anyway, we could go on forever. I love how you introduced this idea. And I think by analogy, is what we do in our Christian tradition, cataphatic. So God is being, he's revealed himself through, this is what Thomas Aquinas said, the only way we can really prove it, this is our case against the apophatics, you know, the sort of Gnostics, our case is that we prove it by the revelation and analogy as it's working. So I got one that just pounded me over and over at a personal level, and I can go to some academics and so forth. But a lot of what you're saying could be reduced to this analogy, spiritually, metaphysically, and so forth, of the prison. And how do we escape the prison? I don't even like Matrix, because I can use some prison examples here. But this living room right here, it's sometimes been the most elevating, not just having music, in my own mind. Do I free in my own mind? This place has been a prison. And I'm sure other people, if you've lived in a space, can be both things, you know, this world, you know, the Gnostics of the ancient world would say, it's God put us in this matrix. He's the bad God. The world is a conspiracy. And so the Gnostic, there's some kind of things that are kind of similar, but how do we balance all this? How do we think about this? Obvious examples is that we know when the world's pulling us back and into ourselves, that's demonic. We're made to love. That's why it's a command. We're truly going to be happy if we follow God's will to love. It's this inversion of the world, not his reality, the world. So when we literally learn to give it up, that's when our truest happiness. Reflect for a moment, anybody. Like, what's worth living? Back in the day, people used to say, you know, if there was a fire in the house right now, what would you grab? And do you remember, Thaddeus, what a common response would be when you were growing up? You ever thought about it?
The money? I don't know. Not sure.
Well, you know, you're kind of doing it in polite conversation and so forth. You know, it would be the photo album.
Oh, the photo album. Yeah.
Right. Baby pictures. We have one copy. You know, that. So deep down, we know it's family, and family's analogous to the heavenly family. But the prison, let me tell you. I'll give you a little, I don't want to go too long on this. In criminal justice, one of the units is about the prison. One way you could look at the prison, I'll try to do this in a short while. William Penn came to a Dutch land that we call now Pennsylvania, and he created for a while this experiment from Europe in a prison system. And it became quite notable. That's one of the reasons Tocqueville in the 1820s came to America, because it had some success. I'll give you this. It was called the solitude system. And so they realized something's broken in your mind. This is how they thought about the world. There's something broken in your mind or in your soul. There's no connection, you know, what we call different degrees of narcissism. So they put you in a place, family couldn't contact you, you couldn't take letters, but you were forced to make furniture in this just bigger than your own body. And so you'd learn to make shoes, you'd learn to make wood, and even the guards wouldn't speak to you. You were forced, you couldn't have that frame of mind where it was someone else's fault. Only when you were truly, truly crushed beyond something the military can do in boot camp, would you finally have a revelation. The important thing is, when we think people are wired differently, or modern psychology says that it's not possible unless it's a miracle, that's one of the miracles that people rarely will show, is that when you crush a person to that degree. Now, It doesn't always happen in solitary confinement today because they still get contact. They're talking about you have to learn a skill. And when they were released, the recidivism rate was almost 100%. 8 to 9 people transformed their lives and became members of society and were transformed. Now, the more you gave to the prisoners over the years, the more you allowed them to speak. You know, eventually they wanted the shag carpeting, the Buddha statues, the Satan statues, and on and on. So what do you think about that? Today, when I tell my students, like, would you want to like reform people that way? Because today our recidivism rate's 93%, right? Everybody's going there that's broken. If anything, people are getting worse, right? So it's a dilemma. The prison itself is a dilemma. The prison of our mind, the prison of our society is a dilemma. We could fix people, but we're not willing to do it, right? Now, how do we draw that toward ourselves before we think about making an order of the world? And I think we have to, I don't have a great answer right now, but what we always have to rely on is tradition, what's worked. Because again, what's worked and hasn't worked. Back to what Dr. Kaczynski said right now, that experiential aspect. I have in one of my chapters of my book, I have a quick quote from Soren Kierkegaard about solitude. And he goes, in the ancient world, they realized the value of it. It was like spiritual, it was metaphysical. And even the medievalist felt that. But in the modern world, the only thing that they can think to do with it is to put someone in an asylum. So it's this strange phenomenon. To go out, we first have to empty and put God in replacement of the self before we can go out and love. And so we have to break ourselves down before we can even start talking world order or the new H1V1 or anything else. And the reason this is Dr. Deep State, where does all of this stuff with politics have its basis? In theology. Where does theology have its basis? In the ground of being. What does that mean? Each individual, you're going to see the world in accordance with your ground of being. So now I'm in your neighborhood. Can you want to go on with another and expand your story? Or do you want to talk about the ground of being? Because I've been writing about it about hours a day for the last few days.
Well, I don't know. No, very good. Very thought provocative here. While you were speaking, I was thinking about, what is it about these customs I was mentioning? They do require some discomfort. In other words, the kind of norm of a social event like this requires you to think about something other than what you want at the moment. Your own ego, you kind of are being moved, encouraged with a variety of incentives as well as sanctions. If somebody were to kind of make a bad joke or say something self-centered, you know, there'd be a kind of social pressure that they would feel, a bit of a shaming, and they feel that as discomfort, and that would move them not to do that. So I'm just thinking to myself that these little customs I was mentioning that suggest something higher than your own will, your own power at the moment, your own ability to manipulate the situation to get what you want. It causes you for the moment to kind of think and do and feel what you don't like want to think or feel at the moment in your fallen nature. And it's good. So the norm is moving you to a higher willing, which requires you to mortify something of your self-willing. And if you do it, and if you trust the process, you will have an experience of a kind of vista opening up, a relational vista. You'll feel expanded. You'll feel like, I'm participating in something that actually is what I want. I mean, that's the purpose of all these things that I mentioned. What's the counterfeit of this? So it's always going to be a counterfeit. That's what I'm seeing everywhere. And so the counterfeit is going to be a similar structure. It's going to be, here's what you want. I don't want to wear a mask or something. Let's just use the mask example. But and then there's the pressure to wear it. So that feels like it's a custom, right? And then you have this good custom from tradition, from the transcendentals. And yet it's actually promoting you So, and it feels uncomfortable again, and you have to get out of yourself, think about others. It has all these same features. But what is the participation that you're moving towards? It's actually inverted. You're actually moving towards more of a kind of tyrannical self-worship, but under the guise of some kind of social consciousness and charity. So there's this sense that you're depriving yourself of something you want at the moment, the mask or getting a shot or staying 6 feet from people. Whatever. I'm just going to use those as a perfect example I'm talking about. And you're doing it for the social. You're doing it for others. That all sounds good. And that's what motivates people to do it still. But in truth, what you're actually doing is you're simply obeying the will, the arbitrary will of another. You're not participating in a higher will. You're not participating in something, a genuine common good. You're not participating in the transcendentals. You're not participating in the relational goods like love and friendship. You're actually simply subordinating your desire and will at the moment to someone else's who has more power than you. but that's cloaked. And so you're actually falling into a kind of deeper servitude. And then that slavery actually goes back and makes you more self-willed. That's actually the purpose of it, to make you more narcissistic. And so it has this kind of diabolical diabolon, a fake icon of transcendence. And that's what's happening to society now. And that's what, you know, communism is, totalitarianism. And it's I think it's important to recognize that the difference is subtle. So at that party, there was somebody in charge, and that person was in charge of kind of coordinating and organizing it. And there was hierarchy, and the person in charge was kind of set to, in a way, you know, ensure that the common good was being achieved. So that person might have to say, no, don't say that, or set some rules for dress or something. And all those are not arbitrary impositions of power. They're actually participations in this higher good, which ends up, going back into the good of the souls of those who are under these norms. And so it all works together for a kind of expansion of the self and a kind of participation in higher goods, ultimately in God. So just, and the totalitarianism mocks that. It imitates it, counterfeits it. And all you have now, and the trajectory of all this is, it's either I do what I want and I exert power in an arbitrary way that's irrational and is against any kind of transcendent ascension. It actually brings me further into hell, further into isolation and non-being. Let's put it that way. It leads to non-being, anti-participation. Mm-hmm. It's either that or I'm obeying someone else's will, which has the same trajectory, both for themselves and for me. But in that case, though, and this is the transformation of libertarian liberalism to totalitarianism is, yeah, I'm now getting the benefit of thinking or somehow being able to construe what I'm doing as somehow participating in a higher good. So I get that kind of sense of I'm a good person and I'm virtuous. And that's a mockery of the common good in Christ. And but actually all I'm doing is entering into the arbitrary will of another, the collective. In this case, not even the collective, it's simply the elite will, the will of the elites, the Kabbalists and the New World Order people. And so I don't know, it's subtly similar to the natural orientation we have to obey norms and to subordinate our self-will to the good of the community and the relationships. And that's why it fooled so many people. And that's why people defended it. And they did it with a Christian veneer. They did it with Christian noises. And to me, this is the ultimate diabolical deception. So, yeah, I just Thoughts on that, if you like.
Yeah, I'm going to turn it over to Will, but real quick, yeah, secularism has its own liturgy. It's a counterfeit of the Christian liturgy. Why do they do it? Because all of us have a longing for transcendence and hierarchy, even though we're right. told contrary. So we square these, and that's where they want us in this juice maloo world. But yeah, it has its own liturgy. And you know, a great example in the popular music, you can be hearing a love song. And it's talking about nice things. It feels nice. And I'll ask my wife, is this the Christian station? I literally don't know. I can't tell the difference. And that's how the whole political order is right now. And I'm sorry, in simple historical Catholic things, you can't put that in front of Christ at the end of your life, that I was a good person in the way that society would define it. You can only do it in the way that he has revealed through his grace. And it's subtly different because, okay, so I'll let Will talk. I think Will probably had a lot of thoughts when we think about this order. You're talking about niceties and hierarchies and why people want to do it. It's called civilization and not necessarily Western civilization. That's the quintessential features of civilization and why it's motivated. In the Catholic imperial order, in the integral system, it's most perfectly ordered because it's always going to be assured its transcendence unless it's subverted. Will, I was thinking so much about going a certain place, and I'm sure you were too, about what totalitarians do. They take away these niceties. We obviously know that's what's going on to some extent when you're learning or being reprogrammed in the military or in a prison system. But how specifically these techniques that totalitarians use, of course, Juice Malou, Hannah Arendt was famous for kind of really looking at those techniques and what they do and how they break it down. And it is exactly what you're talking about, Dr. Kaczynski.
Well, just one more thing about that. Sorry if I cut you off there. I was just going to say the ability to detect the counterfeit is completely a function of whether you've had the genuine experience of this participation in common goods. And so that's why it boggled my mind. And this gets to the Matthias de Smet's thesis, right? It must have been that the vast majority of people in the West, let's say in America, especially on the coasts, were not having this experience at all. They were already within the dialectic of I do my will only, which I'm supposed to be ashamed of, but actually celebrated at the same time. And then I also do the will of another, which I don't want to do because it's enslavement. But if I do it, then I could also be praised for it as somehow selfless. They were already involved in counterfeit culture, it seems to me. So when the totalitarian onslaught came and gave them a kind of instant sort of counterfeit here, like, look, wear this mask, take this shot. And then you had the Bergoglio telling you to do that in the name of Christ. Which is beyond unspeakable evil, by the way. I'll never get over that, ever. But the minute that was handed to us, right, how many people did not recognize that as a counterfeit? I mean, it seems to me the majority of people took that as real virtue. And it just boggles the mind because that means that so many people were already living in a kind of hell to be able to not recognize that as a counterfeit.
I have to jump in before you, Will. I just think you hit the nail on the head in the most obvious way. I've never read the guy. I'm sure you have 1,000 times. I believe it's Chesterton that kind of gave that example of the bill, of the real bill, and that's what he's talking about. I think that's it. The people that never had and Calvinists will, you know, use their little tricks about, you know, what they do for election. But I believe that's what it is, the authentic experience, unless you've had that. And, you know, that's why the whole Baudelaire moving from civilization of the sacred is relevant there at the macro level. But at the personal level, that's it. And we all know whether you go to a Protestant church or a Catholic church, you know, people are kind of always kind of thinking, am I religious or as saved as the next person? So we're always kind of checking our own selves that way. But I think that idea of, you know, and we, And that's what alternative music just builds off this idea. If you're really into this, we're the band that's a little bit more authentic somehow. In a world of commercialism, sometimes you have to be sold that the idea that the guy down the block did it, even though you know he's connected to somebody that's connected, right? So we crave that authenticity because we know at some points had it. When we used to think our grandparents were square, now there's something in our older mind that there's something romantic of what it must have been kind of like to be that connected to the authentic lifestyle that they lived and to really grab a chicken's egg and so forth. Will, please help me out here. What are you thinking?
Yeah, I was going to say the thing that liberalism and totalitarianism share is that they shift the ground of being, you know, from act to potency. And if we look at the Enlightenment, this moment of the nominalist revolution in which this you know transcendental economy of symbols and hierarchical order is shifted to become something that's arbitrary and based upon power. So I'm bringing this essay. It's called "The Promise of the Name." It's about the Jewish nominalism, and so it kind of is a contrasting. William of Ockham's negative nominalism versus a positive idea of nominalism within the Jewish ground of being. So I'm going to quote this. It says, "This special epistemological formation, which explains the difference of two types of nominalism, is closely connected with an even more fundamental metaphysical difference, two very distinct visions of creation." So here, the ground of being. "One, Christian and predominantly Neoplatonic, is based on the idea of participation, while the other, Jewish, always somehow tangential to Neoplatonism, is based on the idea of separation. In the participatory model of creation, world is created and sustained by God's permanent emanation. Beings granted the gift of being remain ontologically dependent on the divine power in which they participate in different modes and degrees, and thus form a hierarchical order of higher and lower regions. On the other hand, the non-participatory model of creation based on the notion of strict separation, this metaphysical hierarchy is replaced by a quite anarchic ontological multitude, as Spinoza could have called it." So one of the things Doug and I are looking at is this dialogue between Maimonides and Thomas Aquinas, who Thomas Aquinas calls Rabbi Moses, over negative theology and the apophatic theology. So, and what is the ground of being? What can we say about God? What can we not say about God? How knowable is God? And so the distinction that Thomas Aquinas makes, correct me if I'm wrong here, but is that we can know God through analogy, through likenesses. And so this sets into motion this hierarchy of symbols. And the negation of symbols is what is the access to the transcendent with the Maimonidean principle. So the ground of being is the negative, is the negation. It's the absence of anything that can be called being or non-being, as we would say. So, the ground of being as nothingness, the apophatic negation of being, the meta-ontological void of which no analogy of or likeness can be surmised. So, what stood out to me with this Catherine Watt, when she's talking about, say true things, what is the nature of truth? It has to rest on this ground of being. It has to rest within this idea of what is, transcendentally good. So if we have this idea, within the Jewish Kabbalist idea of creation, that language produces reality, that there's an infinite separation between God and the being that we inhabit. And the only thing that sets reality into motion is the process of creating language. Then language becomes code. It becomes pure potency that supersedes any aspect of a transcendent. So
it replaces the transcendent. It substitutes for it. It separates you from being, real being, and then it replaces itself as the thing you're encountering and desiring and wanting more than that which it's supposed to point to and reflect and manifest and join you to. So you end up resting in this diabolon, not a symbolon. This is from Schindler, a diabolon, and that's similar to like resting in the option and never actualizing it. Resting in the bad infinite of options as the goal of life, as the kind of point, as a kind of fake salvation.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's an artificial transcendence, but it looks almost like the real thing. Our whole right. system is, our whole, it's so deep in our Western culture that we don't realize that we live in a system that's always constituting itself and yeah. acting like constituted. And it's right. not a simulation of a truly constituted, it's not, it's a, it, that's why it's out of context. It's a simulation, one step removed. And the effort of the World Economic Forum is to make the simulacrum one other step removed from reality. But Will's good at that part right there. And we're, you know, that's the final tweaks on what we're doing. How do we guard our minds? Some of this is obviously grace. How do you get the grace to even have the authentic experience? But we can work with that grace. But what we have to kind of escape this is our tradition. I mean, really. We have our tradition because these are the exact things that Aquinas is talking about. We have our habits. We break those habits. We are who we are because of what we do. This place is a, to me, this is a paradise. When I do all the things you were saying, Dr. Kaczynski, I have a frame of mind that I have to do something I don't want to do. I do it for my family. I do it for God. Yeah. I do.
Yeah.
In those moments, I have what Aquinas would call an intellectual ecstasy. Or I can have the worst moments being left alone here for a month, and you know what a guy can get up to, right? And that is the worst prison. I'd rather live in a prison doing my work intellectually than be here with all my comforts, shackled to the demons, okay? And I think what we're talking about when we're talking about the whole world's deceived, it's in this subtle way, I think, that you're talking about. It's in this metaphysical way that we're chained to the system that tells us, hey, you're okay.
And so here's a conundrum that is coming out of what we're saying here. So if you think about it, the Jewish leaders before Christ had the tradition, right? They had the divine tradition. What they did, some of them, most of them maybe, especially those in power, was to encounter this tradition, receive it, participate in it in a diabolical way, such that it became a fodder for their own will to power and ego. Now, there was nothing wrong with the tradition in itself. I'm not talking about the distortions they added to it all. I just mean the genuine Torah. And they received it. And somebody like Joseph of Arimathea received it and let it become a symbolon to join him to God. And therefore he recognized Christ and loved him and repented. The Pharisees had the same tradition, the same set of good divinely revealed symbols. And they encountered them in a diabolical way and turned them into simulacrum and counterfeits for themselves. So St. Paul did this too when he was Saul, but then he got knocked off knocked off his horse. Was it just he fell? Was it on a horse when he got the revelation from Christ? Or am I just imagining that? Anyway, he was blinded, and he said, Jesus said, "Why are you persecuting me?" And the scales fell off, right? And I'm just thinking today, there are traditional Catholics, and I've been with them in certain institutions of higher learning. And my evaluation of these is that they have the tradition, the purest mode of it, but some of them are in a diabolical state vis-a-vis that tradition. They are using it for purposes of ego and prestige and manipulation and a kind of virtue, Calvinist virtue signaling. I go to this mass. I have this many children. And they are some of the nastiest Nietzschean type people you'll ever meet. And I don't even know if they know they're doing this. But I guess my conundrum is it seems to me there's two aspects of the problem. One is a set of inauthentic diabolical icons and symbols. Objectively speaking, there are just false symbols around everywhere. But then there's the problem that even if you have the good symbols like tradition, okay, like the authentic tradition of both natural and supernatural, right? There's something in us that in a way, always already has to be in the right orientation towards those symbols in order to properly allow them to do what they're supposed to do. And that part can't be a function of your immersion in authentic symbolic reality. It's almost before that. And that's the mystery. Like, how do we fix that problem? How do you make it so that someone doesn't misuse or it's like giving to, don't give to dogs what is holy kind of thing. Do you see the problem I'm trying to express here?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's something. Even Taylor would say, how did we get to the secularism? Ironically, it was people to try to getting out of the religion through their charisma. And then you had the competition. It's the very competition that created the pluralism. But yet there is very, and this is part of, Will could go on forever about this, is they always have to create a strain of messianic characters in their tradition because it opens the charisma. Otherwise tradition becomes essentially corrupted, right? And solecistic, you know. And I should really turn this over to Will, because, you know, this is his thing. But in the cave, everything comes back to the cave. What makes the person turn up? Why do some people get grace? And in the cave, I think this part of the analogy that's helpful is that they are also predisposed. But then again, wasn't it the grace in the first place that
predisposed
them? You go to an infinite regression. That's called a mystery. And that's what the Gnostic mind does. So we want to be careful with some of the boundaries of that. And what do we kind of know? We end up calling, we kind of know in a sort of connoissance way that, you know, we come back to, in our own minds, these habits. And Aquinas would talk about them in our own lives and society to encourage them for the reasons that you mentioned, because they're beautiful. And how do you get that? Because we love the true and the good and the beautiful. But how do we do that? Because we had some kind of experience that when, even in the secular world, we're our best selves and we're in tune with natural law, it still feels like we're working within some realm of God's grace. But I think what she was saying at a pragmatic level with our friend, you know, you got to pick your battles. When are you going to talk about some truths and not others? And, you know, it opens up a whole can of worms when you say true things. I do appreciate this about what you've done, Dr. Kaczynski, is in your book, you put your cards on the table. And I was thinking that because it was so fresh to read this. I knew that when you wrote the book, you were saying, at least when I'm dead, I'm great with God. I knew that I did what I'm supposed to do. Everybody else, you know, that's your deal. Because that's what I identified when I do it. And I think, to me, you know, there is something about the Protestant ethos that there is some truth to, some people are on fire and they got the spirit, and the spirit can run in a lot of different directions. So why does it do that? It's a conundrum, right? So we somehow have to match faith and reason, tradition, and have kind of a healthy appreciation for that charisma, but it's always the source of revolution in our own minds and society, right? So, and that's the trick of this sect that Will talks about, the Shabbats, how to kind of always capture a little bit of that within the rigidity of their career to keep it alive. And that's through that very charisma, they're able to be at the top of their messianic heap. And part of that idea is that charisma has to be unleashed through world monopoly. But, you know, Will can talk about that part if he'd like to. But I'm sure you have a lot of ideas going on, Will.
Yeah. The way I understood your question, or the conundrum that you were presenting there, Dr. Kaczynski, was, you know, how did the bearers of the symbolic order of the tradition transform that into this diabolical simulacrum that is motivated by the will to power? Does that sound like what you were trying to?
Yeah. Yeah. How does that work? And also, how is it that it's not as if all we have to do is make sure that all the externals in our culture are properly sacramental and cosmically oriented in the right hierarchy, the liturgy is good, the culture is imitating the liturgy. Even if you have all those, right, which is kind of what the Jews had when Christ came, and they had this theocracy that was ordered by God, it was that very theocratic culture, diabolically construed, that led them to crucify the reality of which that symbolon, that set of assembly of symbolons, was actually supposed to cultivate in them a love for. And that's a mystery to me. how that works.
I do think it's tied in with the mystery of iniquity, because those exact ingredients right there are going to be happening on the reverse side. That's part of what we're doing, is they're recreating the conditions of the spectacle here and there at the same time under those. And it's part of teasing out the Antichrist. And that's part of the book we read by the unknown author.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. And so they're in part reproducing it, but it's not that God isn't present and this isn't his timing. They're playing with the timing. And so it's two things are kind of happening at once. But I cut you off, Will. You were really talking there.
Yeah, I was just pondering that a little bit. I think like the prophetic, the eschatological, the idea of what the Messiah was to be and how Christ sort of disappointed that that Davidic kingship idea of, you know, who was going to conquer the Roman Empire. I think that was a piece of it. And, you know, the incarnation, yes. There's also this aspect of the incarnation, which brings the symbolic order into a kind of new economy of relations between, you know, like with the sacrifice, for instance, of the mass, how it works through this sort of symbolic economy of the hypostatic union, where the bread becomes flesh, you know, like Christ has these two natures. So it kind of has this symbolic union that pulls it out of the literal and attaches it to the transcendent and binds to transcendent and the immanent simultaneously. But I say also, like within the law, there's a potency in the law where it can, through being able to decide the exception, being the one who interprets the law, and this idea of like, something we talked about last week with Peter Gumley was that, this unholy trinity of usury, sodomy and idolatry sets into motion this kind of self-referential economy in which, sterility, like the sterility of money breeding itself. So likewise, like the law, this commentary upon the commentary, which is what the Jewish tradition becomes through the Pharisees with the Mishnah, right. You know, on and on and on. And that ability to establish the law, but also, you know, find exception to the law, gives power and potency to a kind of messianic group in history. And so I think there was this unwillingness to relinquish that power, and then seeing in that the word, you know, this power of the word to sort of bend reality. Words create worlds is a common, you know, refrain within the Jewish tradition, and how the law could become, you know, an instrument of earthly power. Go ahead.
No, that's really it. That's really fascinating. I just thought of this example of this, perhaps. Sorry if I cut you off. I just don't want to forget it. Before Christ, God was to be worshipped, and you couldn't really manipulate God. He wasn't vulnerable to manipulation or power. He was transcendent. And with Christ, you now have the invitation to worship God or crucify him. Like literally crucify, like he is now vulnerable to your power. At the same time, you could be that much more vulnerable to his power. Like the stakes are much higher, right? So there's a kind, this is the Antichrist idea, I think, that Doug was talking about. Like in other words, by God making himself vulnerable to human will, human power.
Yes.
In a way that's completely incomprehensible before Christ and still is incomprehensible. It's almost like the occasion is there in a way to use this symbolon for the ultimate of diabolical purposes, that is, impose your will on it, which actually does damage to the thing. It hurts it. And then there's a tendency to think that can't be God, right? I mean, that was the Jewish problem, wasn't it? It can't be God if he's vulnerable to human will. Yeah. That's the definition of not being God. You can't, right? And so...
That's the moment history smash. That's the moment that the prison person smash it. It smashes the metaphysical somehow. It's inexplainable. But right. Literally, that was literally the transcendent coming into the physical. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so that's all I wanted to say, Will. Go ahead. I just wanted to bring up that idea. I just think that has resonance with what we're dealing with here. Like the traditionalist, let's say, the Catholic who has been raised with the most rich, robust education, homeschooling and tradition in the Latin mass. And he's got he's got all the symbolons there. That person can become the most diabolical if he just tweaks his orientation a little bit and doesn't submit to all that in humility, but somehow in a state of exception becomes kind of the arbiter of it all, or uses it for some worldly purpose, or allows it to kind of inflate his ego or something like that. All that could be turned instantly into the opposite. And I guess that relates to the state of exception idea. I mean, that's what happened to the Jews. The best of, what is it? The corruption of the best is the worst, in a way, right?
Hey, yeah. Well, I'm going to ask you a radical question. I should ask it off air. This is radical. But if there was a perfect inversion down to the nuances our author was saying, you know, down to that micro level of inversion with the Antichrist, is it possible that there would at some moment, at least seemingly then, there would have to be this self-attack? And that's why there's this always idea throughout history about the number one third or whatever, but that would turn not in the way in perfect humility and love that's inexplicable to us in our fallen state. That's how he conquers. His love is inexplicable to us. If we're in true meditative state, when we see him in his bloodied state on a cross and an icon, that's what we should feel. That's a love that we, and that's back to your party. And even if people are, that's what's motivating it. Should the residue should still be around us. That's why, that's what we're going for. In that one sense, it's love, and residues are in our family and taking care of others and feeling even for animals, right? It's the residue of what he took, because that kind of love conquered will to power. And it was the scapegoat concept. So that's where I'm going with this. Using your analogy of the scapegoat, when the scapegoats, instead of being the Muslims, this time around, the more perfect, it's not just enriching ourselves yet again, that's getting kind of boring. But this time, the attempt to do what Christ did, not in this perfect humility, but in the way that one gift wasn't as satisfying to God as the other, inexplicably, they're going to turn it on themselves. And that will be the real Holocaust that they think is going to give them this leap of faith. At least metaphysically, that seems to be how the storyline is supposed to go. But anyway, that's food for thought. Does that sound crazy?
Yeah. That's what I was thinking too. Like this idea of Christ making himself vulnerable and sort of this scapegoat mechanism. I see a danger there with like integralism and attaching, you know, the symbol on to the political will of creating, you know, and I'd like to talk about, you know, Catherine Watts' two contradictory terms about, you know, creating, you know, distrust of the system, but also lending credence and seeing the system as credible at the same time.
Oh, that was brilliant. Let's definitely talk about that, because that's something I hadn't heard about.
Let's circle back to that. I think with integralism, it's like attachment to the political project of, you know, we have to have this Judeo-Christian recovery of Western civilizational values. There's this shifting of the scapegoat in which I think that's what's happening with this slow reveal of Jewish power in politics and in the media. It's like, oh, you know, yes, you know, Harvey Weinstein and Woody Allen, and we're the bad guys, but you're always ganging up on us. It's like kind of this revealing and concealing simultaneously, in which they're using that scapegoat mechanism and reordering, you know, the sacrifice of the Holocaust to the preeminent cultural referent in replacement of Christ. And then doing it over and over again with these kind of revealed tactics of, you know, why is everyone ganging up on us? Oh yeah, we're in control of the Federal Reserve. Yeah, we're in control of the vaccine rollout. You know, those two things kind of simultaneous with one another. But I want to get to this idea that she says about, you know, say true things, understand that the lie comes coded in the truth. You know, she makes this analogy between the nanolipid coating that encases the poison of the mRNA poison that allows it to become compatible and bypass the immune system's response that would immediately reject poison. So she talks about these two contradictions, and I'm going to say this is like something that I keep, you know, circling back to, is the, you know, the Aristotle's principle of non-contradiction, because this is a big thing within Jewish mystical tradition. It's assaulting this idea that, you know, P and not P cannot be true simultaneously, that they can have two opposing ideas be true simultaneously. That's part of the mystical process of creating, you know, a dialectical potency that can revolutionize the world. So, you know, binary distinctions are under attack by the cabalists. There's this principle called the idea as two opposites in one subject. So she says that when we're presented with this this agenda, this, you know, medical tyranny agenda, this attack on national sovereignty, we're presented with something that that contains two contradictions. One being legal, medical, and educational systems are still credible and functional, so they're creating that impression, so that that manufactures cooperation. And the second contradiction is they have to appear corrupt simultaneously.
Right.
So I find it curious, and that, you know, in the recent news cycle, we have Catholic integralist Taylor Marshall announcing his run for presidency. And, you know, he obviously has credibility and seems like he stands for the right things and would be the answer that we're looking for. And then we also have, on the other side, we have Robert Kennedy Jr. running for president. And this immediately struck me as this attempt to inject legitimacy into something where do we even, are we even having an election? I mean, do are the votes even counted? You know, so why are, I know like we have a certain fondness for both of these people, and I don't mean to sort of sweep, you know, sweep them totally out of the picture or, you know, challenge their credibility. But it seems like the only possible motivation for this kind of move is to make the system still seem legitimate in some way. And that allows the spectacle to harness more of our attention and then recuperate this Catholic integralist worldview into this political will.
If I can jump in real quickly, just the perpetuating part of this dialectic is that what the Bible calls double-mindedness, to hold these two things. And Nesta Webster would say it's the foundation of liberalism, these two absurd things, liberalism and equality. And that's the motor force of it, is this absurd contradiction to pretending to be the same damn thing. And so we're always in society pitting these things, you know, in Fox News, you know, they're doing it constantly to the mind. And so, and I have a video, I think, from 6 years ago called The Magic Bullet Theory. It's that moment that totalitarians put in their idea. So they constantly want you to be double-minded. So one of the things that can pull all this together, whether we're in a prison or the party or something like that, you know, when we have that command not to be double-minded, I believe it's from Timothy, I'm not sure.
Let your yes be yes and your no be no.
Say again?
Jesus says, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Everything else is from the devil.
Well, yeah. Absolutely.
So we have interior character quality. You know, when we have our own vices and make our own prisons, we lie to us first. We lie to ourselves first. We know, because we're going to be convicted at the end of the time. I think there's three parties. One is ourselves, one is the devil, and one might be that. But we all know in ourselves, we know when we're convicted. We know when we've crossed the boundary, unless you're a psychopath, right? I mean, I've even talked about people that respect natural law but aren't in love with the Christian tradition. They know, I hope, when you've done something wrong. But, you know, I ask this to students and half of them aren't sure. But we know when we've crossed that threshold. So our no's be no's, our yes be yes, to be this integrity from within. So we start everything from the inside out. Because in this world, maybe we can't save everybody else, but to finish the race in the way that Paul is talking about, to have our yeses be yeses and our no's to say true things, it does come back to something that is as simple as shutting up and listening to God. The whole Bible starts with not a lot of theories. It says, love me, obey my commandments, love everybody else. And everything else kind of follows from that, including the Ten Commandments. And that's order. And that's what the best system, going back to the system and what you had to say about traditional Catholics, you know, us being Catholics less than 2 years, just a little over a year, we're obviously not going to go there. I've never had that much experience. Will's done the experience. One of the suggestions from a video called the Academy of Ideas, they did an episode called Menticide. So the idea of menticide, we're living in the simulacrum with the powers that be, the ruling elite. That's kind of the language we used in the middle of 20th century when we were looking at totalitarianism. That was the common word, the ruling elite. They want us in a perpetual state of double-mindedness. That's when they can induce their agenda. And so they want you broken, demoralized. And I think most of us have kind of heard about this kind of thing before. The solution at the end of the video.
By the way, this on the micro level, the psychopaths do that in the micro level, like on a family or something. Same exact thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it is funny that everything is connected to everything. He's suggesting we can maybe have alternative communities. My sense with this is, and you know this from Gerard, that you can't really go back exactly and create the past, but we can do it like with fashion. We can grab stuff here and there. It's just where the world does move in sort of just this incremental fashion. We have punctuated equilibrium, and then we really have to get our house in order personally or socially. I think just the best thing we can do is, you know, obviously when we say be prepared, this thing's been going on for 3 years. I got prepared, you know, I'm fatigued from all of this, you know, kind of preparedness. And so I think, you know, it is so important to understand this peace of mind that Christ speaks about, finding this peace of mind in our world. And, you know, we're in the cave each day, in a sense. How are we disposing ourselves? How are we working with the grace that we have at that moment? And I do want to say that about that's the theme that I kind of figured out from the beginning to the end of Dr. Deep State. You know, you talk about politics. It comes back to theology. It comes back to the ground of being. It comes back to this sensory, Vogelin would say. You censor it between you, society. If you're in a nasty room, you feel that vibe. Egregores bring you into another, you know, kind of mimetic vibe zone. So we're in sync with the world. And when we're at home and we're alone, at some point when you're really maturing, if you're sinning, you're not getting away with it anymore. Like when you're really committed, that when you're really authentic and you really get in your mindset of what would a saint do at this moment, the people that we want to be would take that liberty of being able to do anything they wanted to, and they would praise God in that moment. As far as what she thought, I thought there was a couple things problematic. She called it, she didn't call it the globalist. We're talking about Catherine Lott. She didn't say globalist. But yeah, she called it they were kind of the intruders, the invaders. The other guy was equally kind of vague. The trip with all this reveal, all the limited hangout stuff always kind of comes back to simply this. And when we don't have to do this, you just, it's teleological. So you can even go back to Chardin. What glues them together over the centuries is this demonic aspiration to remake the world or to participate like we want to participate. They're attached to a false, but very similar, Teilhard would say, it's like the Logos. So the simulacrum is like literally a very similar version. And how do you tell it? It's a good knockoff. And you have to have experience of the authenticity.
And the thing they want the most is for us to be good parishioners and good participants in the liturgy they're giving us. They want us to choose that liturgy over the true liturgy, right? They have to get us to choose the simulacrum, the diabolon, over the real. And they want, this is a Michael Hoffman stuff, Revelation of the Method. They want us to know that it's false and know that it's against reality and choose it anyway. A good example, I just bring up a quick example of this. Like 9/11 was, I think, one of the first onslaughts of all this. So 9/11 was a kind of liturgy, a black mass. It had all the numerology, it had all the spectacle, it had everything going for it. It had the scapegoating, it had righteousness that you can get from identifying with the right Manichaean God, the American state. When the American state was crucified, it came back, was resurrected. We had its enemy, we had the good guys, right? All this stuff. I wrote about this in one of my chapters in the book. But one of the things it wanted you to do was, and this is why they had Revelation of the Method. This is why they allowed, I think, certain things to get through that were obvious, right, to your lying eyes, like Building 7, for instance. And also they like to mock and tell you what they're doing in certain ways, right? So that you could look at that and say, part of your mind is saying, I now know that this isn't what they told us. And then the other side says, but look what I get when I go along with the liturgy. I get self-righteousness. I get to hate an enemy. I get to feel solidarity with the chosen group, the righteous group. I get to have a little Manichaean universe where I'm saved. I'll choose that. Now, at that point, you're in bad faith. You're in bad conscience. You've committed deliberate knowing idolatry. They want that. They don't just want you. They want to tell you that the masks don't work and then you put them on anyway. They want to tell you that the shots kill you and then you do it anyway because it's a good sacrifice for evil. I don't know, whatever you want to say. They want you to do it. They want you to knowingly participate in a lie and then tell yourself it's still true or good. So they want that double-mindedness. Whereas the Christian liturgy never does that. Christian culture will always tell you the truth, even though it's mysterious truth, right? But it will never, it always wants you to be fully single-minded. It never will want you to be compromised whatsoever. And then it gives you the ability and the grace to be able to be that way. The liturgy itself is both vehicle of this simple mind, of a simplicity, and also its manifestation and kind of reality. It's God coming to you. God is the ultimate simplicity. And the demonic counterfeit is going to, in a sense, want you to disbelieve it and believe it. It wants you to know that they're lying to you and embrace it anyway. I mean, this is to me what the ultimate agenda is. And I thought 9/11 was doing this, but then the pandemic just took it to the next level, seems to me. And I don't know what the next one's going to be. Again, I can't imagine what the next level of revelation of the method is going to be. But it's got to be coming. And I guess the recipe to prepare for this is what we get back to, the immune system. It's being as simple as you can at every moment, saying the truth. What is it? Say the truth as much as possible. Don't enter into any compromising relationships, practices, because you've got to have that immune system intact as much as possible for the next onslaught. I think that's
all you need. That's all the things we need to have an immune system to fight each day. All of the things you said, and those are all really good habits and good discipline, and telling ourselves, and just simple, every little step. And when we fall, we pick up our cross and we keep going. We have our own theology, but yet the world doesn't tell us where all this is going. But yet they do in the sci-fi. But yes, that totalitarian technique of breaking you down in that way. Over history, when parasites do that, sometimes they just suck the living life out of a society and they themselves get kind of bored. And so they allow new levels of freedom because
ontological warfare, it's a battle over the ground of being. And this idea that P and not P are the same, they need us to be able to believe that because that's the ground of non-being. That's the Ein Sof. Yeah. That's the limitless infinity. And so being able to...
That's the end of 1984. That's what that story is about. That's good,
yeah.
Will.
Yeah. So, and this comes through Kabbalah, the idea that good and evil are both contained in the Godhead. They both... You know, there's no difference between good and evil.
Christ overcomes the paradox. Only Christ can overcome all the paradoxes because he is reality itself, but it's mysterious. But he tells us how to approach him and the disposition that we should have. And one is just being willing to obey this, the awe that's in the world, you know. I'm sorry, I totally cut you off that time, I think, right? Well, go ahead.
So there's this messianic project that we're under. I think 9/11, you know, it's this liturgy of reestablishing the scapegoat, reestablishing the messianic principle in history, overcoming the incarnation and creating this dissolution of being and non-being. So this is from Giorgio Agamben, and he's influenced by this Kabbalist tradition of, you know, the state of exception and how this plays into this messianic age that's coming about. So he says, messianism in religious contests signifies a radical transformation of law as such, because the Messiah at the same time has to reestablish the law as it was before the fall, the prelapsarian stage, and at the same time bring a new utopian world order. The messianic task is thus paradoxical. With Messiah, the law will return to its new form. In the Kabbalist tradition, the law before the fall is God's name written as a medley of letters without any order, that is, without any meaning. The law before the fall is utterly meaningless. With this medley of letters, that is God's name, all other laws can be written, which means that the originary structure of the law is pure potentiality. So we see this kind of code war that's going on with, I saw there's this patent that Microsoft has in which they want to use DNA as a data storage mechanism. You know, the four letters of the DNA, some theorize, corresponds to the four letters of the tetragrammaton. So, you know, just to circle back to what we were saying about, you know, how do we instill an immune system that can preserve ourselves against this onslaught? I want to read this. Sorry, I'm reading too many quotes, but this quote by D.C. Schindler.
This is a good one. We're going to put this on our Dr. Deep State site, so read it clearly well.
Yeah, I'll try. The question of what are we to do ought not be our first question. Mm-hmm. The most radical response to liberalism, the most decisive step outside the horizon it sets, comes not in the form of some political program, whether it be one of subversive cooperation or radical resistance, but in the act of understanding. To understand, not as a means of figuring out the most effective plan of action, but simply as a reality already good, true, and beautiful in itself, and not in need of practical consequence to justify itself, is in the end to recollect and honor the priority of actuality over potency that we have argued is the essence of liberalism to deny. So political action is less important than understanding, because through understanding the source of truth that is under attack by liberalism and the spectacle, we strengthen our immune system. That should be our goal, more so than enacting a political agenda or even raising awareness of the attack. Identifying truth and conforming to it is how we become immune and therefore free. To strengthen our immunity, we'll have to endure some black pills. You know, there's, I think, part of raising our awareness and raising our understanding is seeing how dark things really are and not turning a blind eye.
Well, that's beautiful. And I think this is going to be more pertinent for us as the church undergoes her passion. Because if you think about St. John under the cross, what was he doing? He wasn't doing, he was understanding. He was beholding God on the cross, and he was being infused with divine knowledge of everything. He was learning what reality was at the moment where reality itself was being crucified, and reality itself, the Logos, was helpless, purposely helpless to do anything, right? So Christ wasn't doing anything. Christ was beholding his Father. John was beholding Christ. And we are entering into the state where the church herself will be on the cross crucified. And there's going to be a temptation to want to run or join the Pharisees or deny Christ, all the different characters in the Bible. And I guess it's going to be our obligation and our salvation to just look and behold. And this isn't pacifism. Yeah. This isn't quietism either, right? Because at the moment, I mean, while you're doing that, you are, of course, working, reading, speaking, and resisting. But it's a kind of deep interior surrender. And I it's going to be difficult. It's going to be more than difficult. I think we have to start practicing this, because as our anonymous author tells us, when the passion of the church happens, when it's really undergoing, it's not going to be something we can really prepare for or envision. It's going to be something outside of our plausibility structure, I think.
That's why I don't overly prepare now and overly sweat to some extent, realizing it's going to come out of left field. So the apostle that was there, somebody that took their tradition, was experientially part of the nut of the paradox. Sovereign of the world and powerless, and he took that the experiential aspect into the tradition, into the scripture, into the faith, into the lives and the lifeblood of the church. So that experience, so you're saying in reverse, right? This, and I think one thing I would finish off, as we talked about D.C. Schindler, there's a quick video if anybody wants to catch it, him talking about Balthazar and beauty. It's only 6 minutes long. And there's a paradox there, but part of this disposition and beholding and understanding something that's active and passive, it's something that's the metaphysical. Our feet are on the ground, but we're reaching for something beyond ourselves in this way that's exposed, in a way that's uncomfortable, in a way that I think if there is a clear schism between what we can actually see between a church and an anti-church, it would be about people insisting that they're going to say true things because this is not the inspiration of the apostle at the cross that experienced that still lives and breathes. Something has, this isn't a difference of degree anymore. Your mind is going to know this is a difference of kind. And at that point, it might be dark. Maybe the liturgy is dead. We don't know, but we continue in that frame of mind that you're discussing, somehow being a light in the darkness and carrying what we have to. But we have to be prepared for all possibilities. And maybe what, you know, maybe there'll be a church with a valid sacrament and one without. And that's been a debate for a long time that I'm not interested in getting into because I can't touch it. I'm not that. I'm never going to become that guy that can, you know, cite that. But it's an age of crisis. And so when we get back to the basics, this word, I think that you said, Dr. Kaczynski, this a strange place to get within the nut of the paradox where we're understanding in a Platonic sense. It's very deep, but opening up to the metaphysical and like the reality here when we experience it, sometimes it takes pain to opening ourselves up to this kind of metaphysical truth is going to be perhaps a new kind of pain that we need to prepare ourselves for. But I'd kind of like to, I think we're all kind of want to get back to our lives here. So I'm going to kind of wind it down. Do you want to say anything or just say goodbye for us, Will?
No, I think that about wraps it up for me. I really enjoyed this conversation. It's nice hanging out with you guys again. So let's do it again.
Yeah, me too.
No, I mean, you were really, sometimes Will says this on my phone when I'm trying to do this, but you presented that really powerful stuff today, Will. It was really good stuff. And Dr. Kaczynski, your talking points, and I don't know anybody else in the world. It's funny that we're talking about this. I can talk about this with Will, and it seems like we're the only two people. It's just crazy that we were able to have this conversation and really be vibing with each other. I've thoroughly enjoyed having you on today. And
me too. Yeah.
The rest of your day. Any final thoughts?
Final thoughts. I'm almost just out of thoughts. I'm just, I think we've said a lot. I don't know. Just to get down to earth, I do like the idea that RFK is running for president. Something I like about this, just because he was thoroughly against the bioweapon. And the fact that somebody who was heroically against the bioweapon and did so much good. I work with Children's Health Defense, a local chapter. I mean, there was genuine good fruit there. So I'm happy about that. That's a good thing. I have no idea what to think about Taylor Marshall, though. I'm not sure. I have no idea. I mean, I don't know. I just don't get it at all. I don't want to think too negatively. I don't want to think too What's that?
I jump in and out because he's sometimes got great guests and whatnot. I don't even touch on the thumbnails when he's saying, let's compare DeSantis and Trump in 3 months. You know, that's spectacle stuff to me. But he's a talented guy. Because, you know, when the German bishop was doing the rap thing, and he really is an entertainer. I mean, he in a good sense, he is really a talented guy. How he can produce like Elon Musk level of stuff over there when he's seeming, I mean, he's how some people can do that is beyond me. But him as a candidate, that's problematic. And maybe we can talk about that again. You know,
it's an interesting contrast because JFK is running in the Democrat at RFK, and he appeals to the left, the good left. He appeals to the good New Agers. He appeals to the good secular types. He also appeals to the religious, the Catholics, the traditionalists. Like he's got a big appeal. And then you've got Marshall, who's more on the right wing and doesn't appeal at all. So it's an interesting thing. And again, I agree with you that there's not going to be an election. So I don't know. they have to make it their first point to expose the whole system. And I don't expect either of them to do that. Although RFK has been saying the medical system is, but again, does this come back to what our friend said in our video about this double-mindedness about it being, on the one hand, still fundamentally redeemable, and on the other hand, so thoroughly corrupt that the Klaus Schwab has to come in and fix
it? That's the groove. That's the groove. And if these are like the birth pangs, or if it's just a typical way that totalitarians bring in a new rule, is that they shock you and then leave you and shock you.
Yeah.
So part of the kind of agony can be these kind of characters that bring you in for one more ride. You know, it's kind of like a demon. Let's do it one more time. And so we really do have to think about our insulation and our immune systems sometimes. And that's what the spectacle does. They're going to, you know, algorithmically and demonically, they're going to put those tentacles out there. So we always have to be just kind of careful, but not so jaded that we can't identify and still analyze something's going on. But maybe we could talk about this again as the race advances and throw in some opinions.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do that. Let's see how it goes. I'm happy to have talked. This was a great conversation. Lots to think about. I can't wait to watch it. And thank you again, you guys. Good stuff. Mm-hmm. Good stuff.
Excellent. You're a real gem out there. We really appreciate what you do.
Thank you.
And we're
going to
post your article. So all we're right. going to see y'all. Everybody, Dr. Deep State, we're going to see y'all, and I hope y'all are doing well. Bye now.